Hi, Charu.
Hi.
Nice to see you at this time of COVID.
I know. It's been really tough.
Fab India is celebrating its 60th anniversary this year. And
And
how much of that 60 years have
we're so excited this year to start off on this 60th anniversary when all of this lockdown happened in March. But I think I don't want to lose out on the spirits and still have. Of course, it would have been much more gala if things were normal. But I would
Well, I'm sure we'll get back to it.
yeah.
Take some time, but at least we have this facility,
Yes,
which
this
has
is
been
really a
needed.
boon.
So anyway, what I'm very interested in asking you is this 60-year journey of Fab India. How much of that have you been a part of?
Well, I'm ancient in the company. I started way back in 79, June 79.
Would you like to tell us the those days, how recruitment happened, or how you joined the company?
Yeah, I walked into actually BIM's office for a summer job in 79.
BIM
Yeah,
Bissell.
BIM Bissell's office. And she told me that there was a vacancy in her husband's office called Fab India. I hadn't even heard of Fab India. And so the next day I came across for an interview with Meena Chaudhary. And that's how it began.
That was it.
Yeah, and she said, okay, coming from the next day.
So, had you done any training in, I don't know, in office business, administration?
Absolutely nothing, absolutely nothing. My first job.
Okay. Your first job. So, Fab India in 1979 was mostly exporting,
Yes,
but also in.
very, very small, one store on the ground floor in N13 and N14. N13 had, rolls of fabric, and N14 some bedspreads, saris, table linen, and that was it as far as the home market was concerned. On the first floor, we had an office, export office, with three departments: export, production, and finance, with John Bissell and Meena Chaudhary. So that was our entire team. Of course, in the store, which used to do very, we used to bill like 5,000-6,000 rupees a day. There were staff which was in rotation from the school.
From BIM
Yeah,
Business Playhouse
BIM
School.
Bissell's Playhouse School. So they used to work morning hours there and come in the afternoon. So that's how the store used to.
So, just for our young viewers, N14, N13, we're referring to Greater Kailash Part 1 in New Delhi, which actually the GK1 market has now called the Fab India market.
It was at started being called the end because over the years we actually acquired all of N14, two floors of N13, then N7, N5, and N9. So a lot of people refer to as the Fab India market.
So it expanded, but as I know it, this whole operation was looked after by a team of women, like this very tight ship that
Yeah,
was
except
managed.
for John Bissell in the executive
And John
staff.
Bissell on the helm. So, what was John Bissell's whole idea about, getting in young ladies, bright young things?
Well, he believed that in the Indian women, especially the housewives, because he said they have to go through, mother-in-law, kids, cooking, dealing with a whole family, and so they're so versatile that they can handle anything, all kind of pressures. So everybody who was there initially, none of them were trained. They were all trained on the job. We learned the tricks with John Bissell. He was a great teacher. And that's how it all began.
But it was all manual.
It was all manual. It was
All
all
by hand. I mean,
manual.
not just the product, which was obviously handmade and handcrafted, but everything you people did. There were no Excel sheets. You made them.
But there was no learning. There was no retail, no organized retail. So there was nothing that we could learn from somebody else and
Correct.
implement. So we
Correct.
formed our own ways of running to the textiles committee, having shipments pass, exporting. And it was mainly export business at that time.
Mainly export. But you had a lot of suppliers and you had to communicate with them.
Yes.
So without, you know, and most of them were must have been not really difficult to kind of contact on the telephone. So it was must have been by post, it must have been people going by foot, they must have been coming to your store. I mean, how
did suppliers used to come down? They would be like, I think our main production was all in the north, maybe because you started from Delhi. So it was, you know, Panipat, Amroha, Muradnagar. So most of it was UP and Panipat based. And of course, south we added later where we were, you know, sourcing from Kerala and Bangalore and the other areas. But mainly that is why we were also our fabric so much more heavier and coarser, because in the north they don't make fine counts. Or at least they didn't make fine counts in the past.
Right. But it was also in the beginning only upholstery fabric and home furnishings.
Home furnishings, so yes.
That was not... and I believe that John Bissell and all of your team were so generous that, you know, after you gave orders to your weavers and your suppliers, and if something went wrong with the color or with the fabric or with the texture or the buyer changed his mind, you still bought the whole consignment anyway.
Yes, you know, our suppliers had nowhere else to go. So the whole idea was to encourage them, give them some ideas, tweak their products to make it, you know, viable for the market. And once we placed the order, it was our responsibility. You know, we had to make sure that they do it correctly so that it can be exported. But if there was a mistake or something went wrong because of the season, the dyeing went wrong,
yeah,
just picked up the stock, you know, and tried to move it through our retail store in GK or offer it to the customers. Or
so let us tell me something about how your very famous, and I remember them, the iconic Fab India sale once a year.
Once a year, yeah. We realized that, you know, over the years, a lot of stock used to accumulate. There were samples, there were some rejections or cancellations. And we had only one store
in
Greater Kailash. So there was that much that you could sell through your store.
Right.
So we used to organize, and we organized the first sale where it was actually through word of mouth. And, you know, we informed the textiles committee, our bankers, all who were associated with Fab India, and all the customers.
Right.
And to our surprise, the next day when we came to the market, you know, there were at least about 200 people all around the market, and there was a long queue. People had come in 8 o'clock in the morning and queued up to get their first chance to do the shopping.
Can you imagine? That's crazy. Yeah. You know, all word of mouth.
Yeah. So we had to, you know, 20 people went in and we had to pull down the shutter. The people got in tempos to pick up the stock, maybe to resell, because prices were rock bottom prices. So then we learned a lot of lessons. The following years, we actually printed our invitation cards. They were numbered. There was a different series for the morning, a separate one for the afternoon. And then, you know, we knew that, okay, we're going to allow 20, 30 people at a time. So people would call up and say, I've had, you know, my number is 112. When do you think my turn will come?
Right.
I can come accordingly.
Like the homeopathic clinic.
Yeah. Yeah. And people actually sent, you know, their home staff to stand in the queue so that when their turn was about to come, they could have been called.
Yeah.
And then we realized that, you know, if you're having the 4-day sale, you know, in order so that everybody got a fair share, we would bring in stock every morning and ration it out, depending on that, you know, how many bedspreads we had. So we would say, okay, not more than 2 double bed covers, 4 daris, so many table covers, so that the last customer walking in also had enough.
How considerate, you know, it's not first come, first serve.
Yeah, it was.
Everybody's equal.
Yeah, normally anybody would do that is to make sure that, you know, get rid of it. If it's over in the first day, why should I bother?
That's right.
And then whatever got left was distributed flatly among all the staff members, and we all carried loads and loads of table mats and napkins and things, you know.
Yeah, I've read that you people had a pretty, very hard work, but that you were a close team, you were like family, and that John Bissell, you know, if he saw something new or exciting, or a friend opened a bakery, he would immediately buy cookies for everybody. So tell us something about this. It's so unusual in today's day and age, you know.
Yeah, Travindia was always sort of partying, you know. It was like I said, just 10, 11 of us. And anything, if it's a friend's baked a fantastic banana bread, or there was some pastries coming from somewhere, or Nani would make mithai. Everything came to the office, and we all had a treat. We used to look forward to it. If it was a rainy day, everybody, samosas and jalebis were ordered for everyone.
So
it was like, great time. We used to look forward to all those occasions. Yeah.
He treated you people like family, and I guess that's what made the began the ownership of the brand, you know, and how you spoke about it, and how then the customers who started coming in also continued to come and became family. So, that's really the beginnings of what has become
this. I suppose it's also true because it was a small team, you know. Sure. Now with 320 stores and, you know, the workforce, it's impossible. Now you have to even to remember names of everyone, it's very difficult.
So talking about names, let's get into the cute stories of, a couple of stories of how products were designed, how they evolved, how design evolved, how one kind of product actually evolved into another product. So let's start with this, with one of the stories of one of the daris, which became actually quite that Haseena, for instance.
Yeah.
Very sweet.
Like Fab India was, it was a, you know, a house of home furnishings when I joined. So the main export was Indari's fabrics and bedspreads. That was our core business.
Right.
And Haseena was one of, you know, it came from the old case design, which traditionally people used to use on their bed.
Punjab. Yeah.
And then it was changed, the colors were changed, and it was woven into a cotton dari. And we carried it for years, you know, for 30 years it was there in on our shelves. We probably did hundreds of colors in
Fantastic.
It. It was done in not in wet dyes, it was done in direct dyes, which made it very cheap, you know, 200 rupees. It wasn't color fast. We used to specially say, you know, do not keep it in contact with your carpets, paint colored carpets. And, use and throw dari. And we sold, you know, we exported containers full of it. And then the same design was taken forward in towels. We cut up the daris and made cushions out of it.
Fantastic.
And it was there for always.
But did it also turn into a... another fabric called Hastina.
Hastina had nothing to do with, yeah. But it was probably introduced about the same time.
Okay, but it wasn't one of the evolved, morphed.
No. Hastina, in fact, must be more than 50 years in our system. We still run Hastina fabric.
Oh, really?
Yes. Actually, there are lots of fabrics that we... you know, like the Delhi homespun cotton with which Fab India started in 1960, we still have it in our stores as one of the most popular, and it has, at any given point, we have at least 20 colors running in it.
Isn't that amazing? Running for like 60 years.
So basically, you know, most products that we designed were perennial. There are lots that we stopped doing and then are reviving them, coming back.
The naming of these, all these ladies' names you're taking, Hastina and Haseenas, and how did you name these products? Who named them?
Well, it was Meena Chaudhary who was doing, and the team who decided on the names. So most daris in those times we were named after girls. There were the Haseena dari, Zarina, Sangeeta. The fabrics were Goa, Bhagalpur, Hisar, Hastina, you know, all of these were named after places. there were dharis which were rotak and from where we could get the wool. So there was rotak, ajanta, elora.
Is there something named after you?
No. But yes, there were some of the, you know, children's their names. Then we had a famous Shela bedspread named after.
That's right. Yeah, we had some.
Krishna's daughter. Yeah.
There were some. That's so fun. You know, that means everybody's involved in that product. You know, the supplier has made it. He's also designed it. People have worked on it. The buyers have worked on it. It belongs to everybody. You know.
Yeah.
So that's a big thing. So this is all we're talking about export. And of course, I think you were looking after a very big client who was there.
Yeah, 65% of our turnover was with Habitat, and then we had Habitat in London and France, US, and balanced customers we had in New Zealand, Australia, Switzerland, France, so all over, you know, we were shipping. So our concentration used to be, of course, with the Habitat buyers. They would come every February, and their visits used to be like Diwali for Fab India, because they were our bread and butter. So the whole office used to be whitewashed. There used to be plants put in, everybody in their fineries, all ready to, it didn't matter whether you were working in the store or in the finance, everybody had a role, somebody organizing food, somebody taking the spices out for shopping. And it was like, you know, it was like everybody had to be there. There was no way that you could take a day off. And
clients, after all, you're entertaining your clients.
Yeah. And, you know, whatever came out of that trip used to be, you know, that you used to book our entire year's orders on that visit.
That's very important. Yeah. So how did it, if I remember right, somewhere you had only one store, and then somewhere in the 90s, I think 96 or 98, Vasant Kunj store started.
Yeah. So we in fact, initially it was, of course, only two stores, ground floor in N13 and N14 Greater Kailash. Then we took in the basement.
Okay.
That is when we expanded the retail a little. We had Ritin, who did, Ritin Mojumdar, who did the famous Target and the black and white series. And we sold them till the late 80s. We had them in our store. And besides the upholstery fabric, which was a very, very large range, which continued to be sold in bolts out of the store.
That's right.
We did these Ajanta Daris, the Haseena Daris. There used to be bed covers, table covers, that was it. Then Mr. Bissell, every year he went to the US. He would get some, he would get shirts made for his friends.
Right.
And we would get the fabric from Jaipur, which used to be all blotchy with the prints were not sitting on top of the other. And I would tell him, Mr. Bissell, who is going to wear these? And he'd say, you know, this is the character of the print. It's so beautiful. You won't have two shirts which are alike.
Exactly.
And he took them back, and everybody just loved those shirts. So the orders used to come back. Every time he came back, he went back with some more.
Oh my God, okay.
And these were stitched by his Hindi teacher, Mr. Benjamin Singh, who used to come in twice a week to teach him Hindi. I don't think John Bissell learned much of Hindi, you know, after so many, tried very hard.
But shirts got known in the media.
Yeah. So even the shirts, like it used to be like 20 shirts a week when we started, you know, every time he came back, because there was no transport. All the suppliers were also commuting through bus or scooters or however. So they were all on their cycles. So he would come in every week and bring in 20 shirts.
Look at this. You are now selling garments over 300 stores all over India and some abroad. Mm-hmm. And this has all started with 20 shirts.
Yeah, 20 shirts. And so we used to put them, obviously whatever got made was put along with all the home furnishings into one of the shelves.
Right.
And soon we realized we introduced kurtas, we introduced pajamas, Nehru jackets, and then the shells started multiplying. Two shells became four, and four to six, six to eight, and you know, we needed to take on, so the next door was also converted, and the furnishings then moved across to N5 and N7. Not realizing that one day this will become, you know, 75% of your turnover.
Right. How did you make this? I mean, you must have then consciously started thinking about garments ready to wear for ladies, for children. I mean, that has to have been a decision.
Yeah, so we started with men. We started with men. And of course, there's an interesting story, the how our sizing started for the men's kurta and the shirt, because John Bissell said that he was the... There was no official size chart available. You know, there was no learning from that you could just pick up from internet. Right. There was no internet at that time.
Right.
So, he said that he was the ideal 40 size. So, we took his sizing and actually created, and then it was graded accordingly. Years later, we realized that our sleeves were too long.
Because his arms were very long.
Because John's
Everybody's wearing long sleeves and they have to roll them up.
Yeah. So that's the story of how, you know, and it's the nice thing about it is that even 40 years later, we haven't tweaked the kurta a lot or the shirt. The sizing is what we used to do, leaving the, you know. It's
you're talking to a very old kurta customer.
Yes, yeah.
I started buying my kurtas in Fab India in 1977.
Mm. And also thanks to William, you know, he was very, very sure that he said, nobody is going to touch the core. You want to bring a slim fit, you want to bring a shorter kurta, you want to bring a different kind of a short collar. All of that can be, you know, an addition, but you cannot touch the core. Whatever is the core Fab India look needs to be there. And their customers who've been coming for years, they know exactly their size, you know, what to buy. The next thing to be introduced in probably 82-83 was the ethnic wear for women.
Okay.
We started with kurtas, then moving on to salwars, and of course lehengas or ghagras. You know, they were more actually skirts, but ghera skirt used to be very popular.
Yeah.
Mm. And then a couple of years later, of course, there was a demand that why aren't you doing Western wear? Why aren't you doing, some tops that you could wear with whatever kind of bottom people were getting in the market. Because our fabrics was limited because we were using handloom, we were using cottons, mostly cottons.
Right.
So, you know, making formal wear, especially trousers, was a tough. It didn't lend itself to those.
But how did you design these? I mean, when did you start actually thinking about or getting designers in? Because after all, at that point, then you needed designers.
Initially, like we said, that we sold what we loved. So we designed for ourselves what we, you know, and whatever. Like I said, if John Bissell's the shirts and kurtas were all made to his liking, probably most of the kurtas that were made or garments were done what I like to wear myself.
Really?
Yeah. So, and we felt that, you know, they're going to be more like-minded people. So it wasn't that you were designing for a customer you didn't know. You design for yourself and for more people like us.
More people like us.
Yeah. And I think it was just the right time, you know, people were very into buying Indian products. There was a lot of the khadi movement, people wanted cotton, and I think it was just the perfect timing for us to launch.
And but then you increased your stores, because then you moved out of Delhi and you added the larger cities.
Yeah,
and
first
your product line had to increase and change a little bit from the North Indian.
Yeah, the first store we of course opened was in the branch that we opened was in Vasant Kunj.
Right.
Thinking Vasant Kunj in Delhi, thinking that it's going to be the diplomatic enclave and, you know, Vasant Vihar, and it's going to be a very different clientele. it was very tough. We ordered, we had stock built up because we were thinking of, you know, that it will take off like Greater Kailash.
Right.
But it took at least 3-4 years to pick up in sales. You know, the customer profile was very different.
Okay.
People would, there were a lot of people who were getting it stitched with the, you know, nearby tailor, and they would come back and say, if the fabric is costing this much and I'm paying 100 rupees, why are you selling it for this thing? I'd rather buy fabric and get it converted.
Okay.
So, it was a very, very difficult, you know, we didn't think it will take that long. And then in 96, we decided to open in Bangalore. That was Charles Courier's house that came for sale, and we took that. And that was a wonderful, wonderful store that we opened. And like earlier, when we opened that in 96, then 97, we opened in Chennai, 98 in Bombay, 99, another store in Bombay. So, you know, we were opening like one store a year. And of course, there were, you know, never no formal computers or ERP. So we would, a team would go from Delhi. We would build stock in Greater Kailash, was our like a head office where, you know, we were receiving fabric, we were convert, issuing it out, bringing it back.
Right.
We would go to Bangalore, set it all up, write all the tags, train the new staff on what it was all, you know, what is what, tell them all the different names of fabrics, different names of bedspreads, saris. And then somebody would take turns in being there for 2 weeks at a time.
Holding their hands
till they got going.
But then did you change? You had to obviously add on to your product line, because now you're catering to different season, you're catering to different profiles.
There was a lot of learning, because, you know, being
South,
being North-centric, you know, we were following the season. And suddenly when we opened in Bangalore during rainy seasons, they wanted some jackets, they wanted full sleeves. So there was a huge, some cities wanted shorter kurtas, some wanted, you know, no sleeveless, you know, it's a conservative market. So we had to tweak. So there was a lot of learning in the first 6-7 stores that we opened.
That's how it grew then. You know, this learning would create new designs, new patterns.
Mm. And actually what we did was that we set up, for the first consignments went from Delhi for the first couple of months.
Yeah.
And then we set up production units in each city.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. So we had an independent production unit in Bangalore, in Bombay, in Chennai, Pune. Till we realized that, you know, people started making their own things. So when we go on a trip, we realize, where did this come from? You know, there was... So...
Not the Fab India look.
It wasn't, yeah. So we, you know, and there were like no ERP, so everybody used to make their own codes. So you could just make something, introduce and add on. So to try and restrict that, I used to ask for a monthly sales report and go through these reams of sheets, trying to figure out, you know, if everything is going wrong or if people are just making things on their own. Like, where has this come from?
What happened after that then?
Yeah, so then
centralizing it again.
Yeah, so then we then talked about in 2002, it was serious talk about expansion of the domestic market.
Right.
Exports had sort of come down. And we said that, you know, there was good results that were coming, and I think our turnover then was some 36 odd crores.
Right.
And so there was a formal meeting to say that we should be, you know, now
catering to our young people across India.
Yes. Yeah.
Big, middle class.
Big plans, you know, a whole lot of cities were shortlisted. There was budgets made that we have to reach. That's the first time we actually learned about what your gross profit was, GP and P&L. You know, because till then Fab India grew year after on year without, you know, because it was just a small operation. And we it made profit, but we never had a target to you know, get to, you know,
professionalized yourselves in the 2000s so that you could grow like you have exponentially. That must have been a big learning curve for everybody.
So then we actually introduced, you know, we made ourselves a merchandising department, like you said, centralized everything. We moved on to making a head office, moved out of Greater Kailash. There was a HR department, IT department, logistics. So planning and monitoring. So it was like a proper professionalism coming in.
Not the family business anymore.
No, it was still a family business. It was still fairly small, you know. It was in 2002, we were all of 10 stores. So it was still very, yeah.
So did you think that you have maintained, has Fab India maintained the Fab India look, so-called identity and the look over all these now so many
years? We tried our best to stay within. Like I said, the people who started with Fab India or the core customer then who built Fab India, the passionate, are all in their 60s. And to stay relevant to an 18-year-old and a 25-year-old, that we can, you know, bring them in young and then they move on, we have to tweak our products. We have to become more trendy.
That's right.
Get in. But I think there is always scope to do better. We've tried our best to stay still within the Fab India ideology. Very, very, very strict screening that we do.
I believe there are very small core people who are still scrutinizing every design pattern that comes through before it is approved.
Well, we have a framework of do's and don'ts. There is a larger list of what we don't want to do.
Yes.
And I think when people, the merchandisers work with us, they realize within a year or 2 years of training that, you know, what sells and what, because even if we try and bring in products which are not into our look, it's apparent the customers don't take easy to it.
Even the younger lot of customers that you have, the late teenagers and the early 20s, now they must be demanding new fashion, high end stuff. They must be asking for new things.
Yeah, but I don't think you can be relevant to just about all ages. There will be always some in that age group who would still, you know, especially if their parents have already been buying from Fab India, or, you know, so it will be easier for them.
That's true. Well, I'm sure you have built up a huge committed lot of new clients who are not in their 60s. And I was thanking you for giving away my age. But I'm that initial lot of devoted clients.
Yeah.
And so congratulations again
on
60 years. And I hope both Fab India and its wonderful team stays on for as long as I'm here, at least.
I'm sure it will be generations.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks. Bye.